So, luckily I'm following Bob on his talk about phase plates, because that'll come into play later. But with all of the developments with CS direction for material sciences, and also the talk earlier about the type of microscope having CS directions, we've been interested in seeing if it actually has any applications for biological samples. And so this is just going to be an overview of the work that I've done over in Oxford, England, using the 2200 FS microscope that they have. So, as we all know, we have three main areas that we do research in biology: single particles, electron crystallography, and tomography. And although our workshop is focused on electron crystallography, like Bob mentioned just this last talk, all of these techniques will probably benefit someone from CS direction if it actually proves to be useful for biological samples. So, not sure how much everyone in the audience knows. So, in the microscope, we have real lens aberrations, and CS, spherical aberration, is the aberration in the lens that actually is caused when the electrons that are further from the axis, the lens actually bends them even more strongly towards the axis, and so they never arrive at the same spot. So if you're imaging a point, you actually wind up imaging a disk. And so because of that, you have an inherent size limitation that can be magnified to see detail past it, because it's no longer a single point. The same type of thing is involved with chromatic aberration, but this is only with electrons of different energies, where the lower energy electrons, the ones that actually show some loss, are bent more strongly as well. So, can CS correction for the TEM benefit structural biology? So this is the microscope that is in Oxford currently in the material science department. And here they have, it's a 2200FS, which is very similar to the 2100 that we have downstairs. The only real difference between the basic 2200FS and the 2100 is they have an omega alternative. But beyond that, they've added two additional correctors. They have the TEM and the STEM CS correctors on this. So this is a dual CS corrector machine. So for biological samples, we have a lot of issues. Obviously, we've all been talking about samples. First of all, we have sample order to consider. If we have 2D crystals, the ordering of them, if we have single particles, where we average a lot of individual proteins and cellular sections are quite thick, all of these different sample limitations in terms of what we're looking at cause us to have certain resolution limits. And so pushing it to get higher and better ordered samples obviously will help. But beyond that, we have the major problem of requiring phase contrast as the way that we actually visualize our proteins. So somehow, if we are able to utilize CS correction, we're still going to need to have some way of visualizing the proteins, which is where phase plates come in. But beyond that, we also have the normal damage and everything else, including contamination and vibration and drift. So the theory behind it is, if we have a normal microscope, such as the 2100 downstairs that we use for cryo imaging, it has a CS of around 3 millimeters. If we take a normal defocus in order to see small single particles of around 2 microns, then we have a very high oscillation of the sepia. And while we can see very nice contrast for the lower resolution information, the higher spatial frequencies obviously oscillate more, so you lose some of the information due to dampening of the envelope. However, with CS correction, it's theoretically tunable, that you can adjust it to whatever CS value you want. It's not perfect yet, but they are working on developing that to even wind up getting a negative CS. However, with a CS of around 15 microns rather than 2 millimeters, even a defocus of 40 millimeters would have a very nice spread and would get you out to beyond 2 angstroms with only 3 inversals of contrast. Now, if we actually compare these, so I'm sure a lot of us have heard of taking focal pairs for imaging. And the same theory could possibly apply. Since we're missing the low spatial frequency information, if we're close to focus with CS correction, we could take two images, one close to focus, and then the second one further away, a little bit more defocused, and then use the second one as a way to align the first, to figure out the actual alignment of the first one, so then use the first micrograph that has the higher order information with less oscillations to actually do some of the reconstruction. But if you compare the Scherzer defocus of the 2100, the 2 millimeter, which would occur at about 71 nanometers, it's kind of nice to compare that to what you could do with a CS that's actually corrected. Around 30 nanometers defocus, if we can still see the particles, we could actually have a lot of information transfer. And even though it's that Scherzer defocus for the 2 millimeters one, we still have information out to the same level, but we don't have as many universals with the CPO. So, theoretically, this is nice. CS Control, which CS is the company that creates the CS correctors, actually has a wonderful graphical user interface, and it proves to be very nice. So all of these different aberrations you can correct, and it has two modes where you're either taking it and doing imaging of it, basically, and looking at it, trying to find focus, whatnot, trying to fix twofold astigmatism just by hand, and then this Tableau format, where the Tableau format actually takes it and, using beam tilt, goes around completely across the spectrum to try and calculate if you know you're close to focus, if you know that you have pretty much corrected your twofold astigmatism, then it can start calculating the other aberrations. And after you wind up getting these to be reproducible, then you have pretty much a well-aligned CS correct. And so in the Tableau format, it actually shows you what value is actually limiting your microscope's performance. And S3 is star. So C1 is defocus, A1 is twofold astigmatism, A2 threefold astigmatism, B2 is the coma, C3 is CS, sphere collaboration, and so on. And so it's actually a wonderful program, and you can individually correct one specific aspect, twofold astigmatism and threefold astigmatism, independently, or you can do both first order and second order together. So, first issue. The 2200FS microscope has a URP pull piece, and so there's no actual cryo transfer holder that can be placed inside of the microscope. So, 626 holder, which is the typical cryo transfer holder that we have, actually is about 3 times thicker in size than either the room temperature holder or even this Nikon 636 cleaning holder. So that was a little bit of a shame, but we wound up trying to do experiments that would still allow us to work on it. We wound up using the Nikon 636 cryo holder, the cooling holder, which we have to load at room temperature and then cool down once inside the microscope. And so with it, the first thing that we wanted to do was test out what a normal material science sample that they use for calibration and testing this microscope earlier, to get down to 0.8 angstrom resolution. We wanted to see how much information we could get using it the exact same way we would with biological samples. The furthest spot up at the top, which I should have circled, it's also down here, is at 1 angstrom resolution. It's actually 1.02 right now. But so that shows us that although this is a heavy atom, silicon, that has a lot of amplitude contrast, we know that the microscope, under low dose conditions, can still record images out to at least 1 angstrom. So we know if we don't get that information with a biological sample, it's probably the sample rather than the microscope. So we just wanted to make sure that low-dose conditions was still working properly with the CS correctly.
What sort of exposure was this?
10 electrons per centimeter. to, we did it exactly the same way.
It's a little bit higher magnification than you would use for most of them.
Yes, it is, but basically pulling down the emission, putting in the smallest conductor actually, and also testing the C1. So, here's where the problem with the two can be. We were looking at wanting to use paraffin as a test sample because since CS correction really comes into play beyond two angstroms, we wanted to have a sample that would definitely be able to show that. When we looked at paraffin on this microscope in electron diffraction, we saw out to one angstrom information. But the problem is this microscope has a horrible vacuum. We had huge ice contamination that grew, and after 2 hours worth of time, we couldn't see anything. We wound up spending an entire day where we used the energy filter to try and track how thick the ice was actually growing. And it was, after 2 hours, we wound up losing 80% of the signal just because the ice was growing so thick. So, unfortunately, paraffin didn't really work out that well, but slightly saving grace, we wound up recording hexagonal ice. And we wound up getting 1.6 angstroms with hexagonal ice, only because of the contamination problem. It was so thick, and it really is just a problem of the contamination, I think. I'm not, in terms of paraffin, I'm not convinced one way or another, partly because the ice contamination was so incredibly bad. I've never seen it. It just gets thicker and thicker, and we lose contrast in all information. And the identical microscope at Brookhaven National Labs, I went to test the stem to see it, and they actually don't have both correctors. They only have a stem CS corrector. But they replaced their two oil diffusion pumps with two turbo pumps, and there was absolutely no contamination. We were doing the exact same thing. I wish that microscope with the extra CS corrector. So, basically, we're at a point where there's no real definite answer, but it seems like from theory and from technical advancements and stuff, that in the future, CS correction will be a benefit because it will allow us to have a more pure CPF. It'll allow us to have an envelope that's no longer affected by CS, and even if we get a CC corrector later on, that would be even better. But right now the one thing we know is that the microscope can handle at least up to one angstrom information under low dose conditions. And the future is that we want to optimize the microscope. Obviously, we need to optimize sample prep so that we can utilize this if we wind up spending money on this, that it will actually come out with the samples that we look at day to day. But also, we need to optimize it for biological samples so that the vacuum is good enough that we can actually use it without getting gross contamination in the column. And also, having a stable cryo transfer holder. The cooling holder is very stable, and we saw that one angstrom information, and so it's incredibly stable, but whether or not that's true for cryo transfer holders, we don't know. And so we'll have to find better ways to develop those. Possibly using an energy filter in combination with CS correction and the big one, a phase plate. If we can get some sort of development where we get to a place where the phase plate is actually able to retain much of the high resolution information, then we can have something that actually we can take in near focus images, have the phase contrast from the phase plate, and yet still retain a very nice CPF and information. So, I'd like to thank Nigel Browning and Ellen Stelberg, as well as Angus and Kristen, both in Oxford.
Choice between crash and holders here, I think, just the time we didn't. That's the contamination.
Yes.
Could there be any benefit from a negative CS? You mentioned the possible.
So, I personally don't know it because I haven't looked into that, but Angus in Oxford believes there is for material sciences. And there have been, I briefly glanced at one paper that had negatives, utilized negative CS for energy material samples to get better.
Actually, I had looked into it at one point, and I found that with a CS of about minus 100 millimeters, you could get a very nice low-resolution contrast. I don't remember what the range was, but you have to go to extraordinarily high values of the CS, and there was a question whether the electronics would actually support that higher current.
No, in material science, they use very small values of negative CS, and that works and gives you a much more controllable contrast transfer function. And I don't think anyone fully understands it at the moment, but it is an extra tuning instead of the focus.
Other questions? Okay, then we can go on. Thank you very much again.